With no canvas, subscribe right now. The Maryland Institute College of Art, I'm quite confident that nobody else has this. I have no idea how old this is, but I worked in the audiovisual department and I took it upon myself to make sure that these were archived. Look at this. Anybody want to take a guess as to the year? We can watch this, you can turn the volume down if you want, just look at the visuals. I don't know what else to put with this. I am going to tell my life artistic story. Now, I'm not going to tell my life story, I'm going to tell my life artistic story. My artistic story started very early, when I learned what the definition of creativity and innovation was. When I was in downtown Detroit, Michigan, we had a small house there, my mom and dad did, and I had a bedroom on the second floor. My dad was an architect, and our family was builders, and they were no stranger to whatever it would take to renovate or paint or build or whatever. The time came to paint my shelves in my room. There were built-in shelves in this old house, and I guess they're for books, bedtime stories, toys, things like that. And of all the colors that my dad chose, he chose red. I thought that was pretty cool, because back then I didn't have a good sensibility for colors, and red is, you know, fire engines, you know, and there was this one bedtime story I had my dad read to me all the time about a fire engine. So he painted the shelves, proceeded to paint the shelves, so it seems like it was nighttime. He painted the shelf, and he's getting close to getting done, I guess. Almost the whole shelf is red. And he paints the whole thing except for one last little part that's just bare wood showing through. And I look up, and he gets out of the way, and the bare wood showing through that hasn't been painted yet says my name, Paul. And I'm thinking to myself, oh, when you draw, when you color, when you paint the thing that you're supposed to be painting. You left it empty and the whole rest of it's painted. I learned that day what creativity was. Utilizing negative space to be the subject matter. To challenge a boy's mind at maybe the age of 2 or 3. It left an indelible impression in me. I was creative very early on because I knew what creativity was. I was also a first child. I had to entertain myself while my dad was at work. And I guess sometimes later my mother also went to work. And I didn't have a lot of toys, and I couldn't go too far, but I had a big wheel I could ride on the sidewalk in front of my house. And I mostly played in the basement, and because I could make a mess down there. I had a little closet, and in the closet there I had some toys and different things like that that could keep me occupied. I would build things like blocks and things like that with my father when he was available. But on my own, I had to entertain myself. I didn't necessarily build blocks too much on my own. What I did to entertain myself was act out roles that I saw imaginary characters at the time that I thought were real, such as Batman, the Adam West Batman. I was born in 1965. The Adam West Batman started in 1966. And I believe that I watched, in that house, I must have watched some of the original primetime shows in the evening when my father came home from work, and sometimes that was on. I didn't have any control of the television. I didn't know when it was going to be on, but whenever it was on, of course, that was the greatest thing. And Superman, of course, but, you know, you can't fly, so a boy really can only pretend a little bit to be Superman. And, of course, sometimes a Lone Ranger. But Batman kind of made sense. I didn't have a car, but I had a big wheel. That's going to have to do. That's going to have to be my mode of transportation. So I would create, in my mind, the idea that I was going to be, when I grew up, like Batman. I didn't know that I couldn't. I thought it was real. I had my basement toy cave, toy closet area. I had shelves in there. I climb up the shelf and there was a pipe, and I'm sure it was a drain pipe or something, and I slid down the drain pipe, and that was my, you know, way into the Bat Cave. And then I would run out of the house and get on my big wheel and go down the street and do all other matter of things like that. So my creativity was very much based on active role-playing by myself in solitary confinement or out in the world by myself. I did these things without friends and without toys, but just with a few minor props that I would make. Like a 2x4, if I took a hammer and two nails and put it in the top of the 2x4, maybe about 4 inches tall. Well, that became a radio with some marker drawn on it and two antennas sticking out, like the bat prop radio from the television show. I have one here that somebody made from the original master. But that's what I would do. Things like that. I would try to create batarangs and string and rope. Things like that. And I couldn't actually climb up that, but I climbed up things, and that would be like climbing. Jumping down on things and pretending there was somebody I was jumping down on to foil their crime. I would later come to see that satisfaction would only come from doing good with my creativity. That was my creativity. I didn't really paint and things like that like a typical artist would until much later. In fact, when I was in preschool, I still remember the preschool teachers calling my parents in for a conference and saying, "What's wrong with this boy? He must have issues. He paints like the whole surface of the paper black." I don't remember doing that, but apparently whatever I did was a little bit different than the other kids. I don't know why I did that. Maybe it was just an off day. Maybe I was just experimenting with my finger painting. I don't know. But that struck a chord in me, that I was different when it came to art. Later, the next thing that happened was, when I got into about first or second grade, I was questioned once again for my ways, my mentality, my IQ, whatever. I went in to a doctor even, did Rorschach tests, IQ tests, things like that, trying to determine whether or not there was something different about me. They didn't find anything, with the exception of, they said that I had a very high IQ. Well, I didn't remember or know what any of these things were, but I still have vague memories of the tests and going into this doctor on a periodic basis down at the hospital, probably the one I was born in, Henry Ford, I assume. It was close to our house. But I remembered that, just like with the painting thing black, I remembered that I was different. With this, I remembered, I was told there's nothing wrong with this boy. He just has a very high IQ. So as I went on to third and fourth grade, I got in the enhanced learning programs, things like that. And I just felt as though, you know, there's nothing wrong with me. I can just do and think as I do. And if others think that something's wrong with me, well, they're just off. They don't recognize what creativity is and whatever it was I was doing. And these times are very dark, so I can't comment on them much more than that. But I do remember those distinct things sticking out. Then when I got to fifth grade, there was a boy in my class that knew how to draw superheroes and muscles and the way the shape of the foot would be if it was looking straight onto it. I never thought of that. If you're looking at a foot straight on, it doesn't look like a foot. It looks like a little mash potato pile or something like that. And I looked and studied what he did and the proportions and how the bulging muscles were there, and I started doing what he did. I couldn't draw as good as him. But people would have comic pictures and things like that of superheroes. And of course, as I mentioned before, I was into superheroes. What else are you into? I mean, that's you know, back then, that was the thing, right? So I started to draw, and I appreciated what he was able to do, and I wanted to do it. I went home, and I would trace. You know, back then they go, "Wow, that's so great. What a great drawer you are," and everything. They go, "Did you trace that?" I didn't want to go around saying, "Yeah." And I didn't want to lie. Because superheroes that do good things, well, they're honest, they're honorable, they don't lie, they do good. So I'd come in and I'd have my tracings and they go, "Oh, wow, that's great." And I love the feeling of them saying that. But when they got to the part of, they said, "Did you trace that? Did you draw that yourself?" I just didn't want to have that follow me all the days of my life. So I said to myself, "I know what I'm going to do. I'm going to go home and I'm going to do what it takes to learn to draw. So that I can answer, yes, I drew that. I'm going to abandon the tracing, and I'm just going to learn and practice as many times as I need to how to get those proportions right and get the feeling for the shapes." Kind of like Batman must have trained himself to become a crime fighter and everything that he was. It just became a natural thing for me to draw. And it didn't take very long at all, actually, because at that level, nobody could draw good anyway. So I came into school. I had drawings that were pretty much on par, but in my own style, as the person that I first started looking at. And I got the attention. Now, I remember back at, you know, playing in the basement. I was the solitary kid, emulating the solitary lifestyle, the Batman. But I wanted the flamboyant lifestyle of charging out of the cave on my big wheel and going on this colorful big wheel down the street into the great beyond world. So, when I had somebody say, "Whoa, you know how to draw?" And I took it upon myself to say, "Yes, I do. And I knew I didn't trace. I knew I knew how to do it. I go, this is the beginning of my superpowers. I already had the creativity, the direction to know that I wanted to go. Now I started to learn my arts, my superpowers already by the age of 5th grade. That's how it all started. So I would start to use my drawing skills to supplement my grades, to make sure that if maybe I was a B student without drawing, maybe I was an A student if I added in drawings to all my projects. So it became a lifestyle to use my creativity and my skills to gain the momentum I needed to move forward. When I got to 7th grade, actually it was 6th still, I think, I said, okay, superheroes, that's fine and everything, but let's draw other things. Star Wars came out. I started drawing all the stormtroopers and spaceships and Darth Vader and all that stuff. Not the people. I couldn't draw people, and I couldn't draw, you know, characters that look realistic unless they were just, you know, wearing masks because the faces are so hard. But I would start drawing all these spaceships, and people would just think that's great. But then they'd start saying, oh man, draw something else other than Star Wars. Star Wars was so cool. And I started drawing Kiss characters, Gene Simmons and all those crazy outfits they'd wear. They had a lot of details on them, you know? When you're little, you don't know what to draw. You just draw things that everybody's going, wow, that's cool, look at all that detail and everything. It's better than just a boring-looking person standing there. So I started drawing those things. Then I go, you know what? I just can't keep doing this all the days of my life and just drawing whatever anybody else thinks cool and getting attention for that. How long is that going to go on? So I went outside one day and sat out in front of my house on a chair with my little paper and pencil. And I learned how to draw all by myself using methods that other artists now I see also learned, but I didn't know them. I would hold my pencil up and see how long something was, the angles of the house. I would take the angle and I'd take it down to the sketch pad and I'd draw that same angle on the sketch pad that I saw as I was holding up in front of me. And I would figure, well, if this is this big and this is this big, well, this is like twice as big as that. So when it's on the page, it needs to be twice as big as that, and so on and so on and so on. I got my angles, my proportions, and I'm not drawing perspective yet, but I could draw a house sitting in front of me, and it would look like the house, and I would learn to shade and things like that. And I still remember to this day the awe of me actually learning how to do this on my own. I remember sitting there right now as I speak to you that day. I remember all these other experiences as well. They're linked together. They stand out of my mind. So when I'm sitting here right now talking about this, these things are just telling you what is linked in my mind. Then after that, I found that my free time was getting sucked up. And I was swimming before and after school, doing weight training and running. I was a competitive swimmer for about 7 years. It was all I could do to get my schoolwork done, get over to swim practice, do my weight training, running, swim practice, 2 hours every day. At first it started out 5,000 yards a night, then it went to 7,000, then sometimes 7,500, and most of the times before school, I had up to 11 opportunities to practice swimming a week, and you had to make, like, I think 9 or something like that practices to stay on the team. So if I could get my homework done and go swim and get back in time to watch Happy Days or Three's Company or something like that, well, that's all my day would consist of, and then it starts all over again. There wasn't really any time for any drawing or anything like that. So in an effort to be more efficient, get my homework done, get my, you know, artwork done, get my swimming in, weight training, all my athletic things, the swim team that I was on was the Sarasota Marlins at the time, and that was at the Sarasota Boys Club. And it was such a successful team. And we had girls coming in from the girls' club and other places. And the big swim team in town was the Sarasota Sharks. Well, we were so good that we really gave them a run for their money. But what really happened was, I was at the boys' club and I worked in the art room. And there I learned and grew and got to show what it was that I did. And that helped as well. With all my many hours a day, though, spent with the swim team, I found myself immersed in a world of non-artist types. On the swim team, that's where I spent all my time now. I could draw in study hall and at various times in art classes and things like that at school and get noticed. But I was surrounded by these individuals, and by the very nature of the boys' club, it's really there as a service for latchkey and disadvantaged kids to have an opportunity to go and get off the streets and learn some things like shop and art, different things like that, have a place to go that they can be watched and supervised. And well, there were some troublesome kids there. I mean, when you're on the swim team and you're applying yourself, you're probably less troublesome because you're putting your mind to something. But you don't have anything else but that. I needed something more if I was going to spend that kind of time doing that every day. I didn't stand out at all, other than I was a pretty decent swimmer. I worked really hard, but I had a late growth spurt, so I wasn't as strong as some of them. I said, one time I was at a swim meet, and I had some extra time in the hotel, and I said, you know what? I'm going to take and do a really killer painting of something cool. I had some Dr. Martens dyes. I was learning how to use them. It was pretty much like coloring, but really easy to paint, because you draw it first, and then you just use the dyes to color in, like a really sophisticated coloring book. And I did this motorcycle. I remember the motorcycle. And I drew it out nicely, and then I started painting it. And people in the swim team, they started to highly regard me because of this unique skill that only I had. So once again, I made a level of insecurity of being just another person. I turned it into, oh, that's Paul, the swimmer, the artist. And I had a certain level of respect gained from others. And I didn't fall into the trouble that might have befell me by being, you know, just another guy, being not noticed or whatever. I became special once again. And that kept me on a good track, above board, not having to prove anything, kept me excelling, kept me growing. Well, what happened was, through junior high school and then through into high school, I just happened to have a major great art program there with Brooke Andrews for junior high school. She took me out of the art classes with all the other crazies and put me in a room all by myself with my friend and just let me do whatever I could do over there. And that was great. And then for high school, with Miss Rowan and H.O. Davis, and I came to find out later on that me and one other person went there that we might all know together, Pee Wee Herman. Yes, he's from Sarasota. Went to Sarasota High School and had H.O. Davis. Mr. Davis was a great teacher and a good man, and at that time, he taught me perspective, and I just soaked it up like a sponge. It was the one thing I hadn't learned. Now I could draw everything, except the human face. And I didn't have painterly techniques, but only drawing, and pen and ink, and colored pencil. Then, after I learned perspective, the very next thing was, I wanted to do silkscreen and have these really cool t-shirts and have all these great logos that Frank Frazetta and stuff like that did for album covers for Molly Hatchet and stuff like The Death Dealer. And that's the kind of stuff I would draw and paint. But I couldn't paint like Frazetta with a brush with oil paints. I didn't even know what oil paints were. They're very expensive. I couldn't go down that route. So I wanted to do silkscreens. Saw other people doing it. I wanted to wear my art. That would get attention, right? But Mr. Davis had other ideas for me. He said, you know what? Silkscreen is very limited. It's a very technical process. I think you would be great with airbrush. That's not what I wanted to hear. But I tried it. Got my t-shirt, did some stencils. I think one of the first things I did was a head of a tiger in Barnum and Bailey Circus or something like that. And I did all the lines and stripes, and I cut all those out, and I peeled them away. Sometimes I did it with a poster board or tag board. I would always have that around, and I would draw it out, would cut it, all in one piece. I'd spray mount it on the back and stick it on the t-shirt. Then I would start out with black, and I would spray all the exposed areas with black. And I was a convert when I peeled that paper away. Not only was everything crisp and clean, like the neatest drawing I had ever done, but if you left any tonalities or any blending or anything in there as well, your edges would all be perfectly sharp, but you'd have all the other subtleties that you injected into there. And the reveal was amazing. You had all this overspray and stuff, you just peel that away and everything is boom, perfect underneath and behind that stencil. And then you'd go to your next level, maybe the orange on the tiger's head, and then maybe some white on a gray t-shirt. And before you know it, you had a work of art and you'd never touched the page. Plus, you could take it around like a costume and get immediate recognition and gratification whenever you'd wear it, just like Batman when he would appear in his cape and cowl. It was awesome. So the idea that I didn't know how to use oil paints didn't really matter. I was an airbrush artist. Well, this sucked me in again. My parents saw this, and they wanted me to start having a job and earning money. I don't know how I had time to earn money. I think after high school, I think what happened is, I finally ended up, I think I swam 1 year on the high school team, and all my other swimming was junior high school and before. And so when high school came along and I finally quit swimming because I had lost some of my coaches and things like that and I wasn't happy anymore and I really had finally had an excuse, I think what happened was, well, I had a lot of free time. And my parents found a way for me to use that free time. Couldn't just do art all the time. I guess I should have done art all the time, but they wanted me to make money too while I was doing my art. So I ended up going to a t-shirt shop, and there was a really good airbrush artist there that used to work in Gatlinburg, and he was one of the best airbrush artists. I remember going to Gatlinburg and seeing him there too, and he had some of the best stuff. He knew how to draw. He knew how to draw with air. He'd freehand airbrush, hardly ever use a stencil. I wanted to learn how to do that. Well, I couldn't do it as well as him, but I started with letters, doing those great big bubble letters, because that was what airbrush was good for at the time. That was the style. And I worked at the t-shirt shop for a while and was a cashier and did iron-ons and press-ons and, you know, tended the store and things like that as well, and didn't really get a chance to do very much airbrush there like I thought I was when I was applying for the job. Maybe it's because it wasn't as good. I mean, compared to him, gee, they're not going to pay for me when they got somebody that's really good, that's older, and does just that one thing and does it exceedingly well. Hard to compete with that. So I started doing work. My parents encouraged me to do work outside of that shop and some for other shops. Well, that shop finally found out that I was doing work for other shops. Not that they gave me any work anyway, but they fired me, and I was so glad to be fired. I never been so glad before in my life to be fired. But it still kind of turned my stomach, left a bad taste in my mouth. And it was really a good thing, though, because my parents didn't push me to work again. They just wanted me to do my art. And it wouldn't surprise me to look back and just think, that sour taste, that sour feeling in my stomach, just kind of really turned me off to ever really want to be employed for someone and work for the man and do what they want. I think I had roots in my eccentricity and my self-serving ways even back then, and pretty much I've never been employed. So I went on and just did my art. I also worked with an art tutor as well outside of Mr. Davis at the Sarasota High School, name of Richard Capes. He's a prominent local artist. He taught me how to draw spontaneously and fast, right off the cuff, and just go, 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 bang away, bang away, bang away, bang away. He perfected my skills. He got me to draw with energy and enthusiasm and fast, too. We went around to all the different Sarasota locations, historic landmarks, and drew them. That's what he was already doing for a living. So I started drawing by his side as he would continue to work, and he would show me what he does for a living. I could have gone that way. At first, I thought I'd go to Ringling College of Art in Sarasota and just become a commercial artist because, well, that'd be a nice thing to do. I could do that. I'd learn all the things I don't know. But what happened was the Maryland Institute College of Art came to my school to solicit people. And I showed my portfolio, and they were flabbergasted. They were wowed. They invited me up to the school to attend free workshops and check out the school. My grandmother and I went up, and I won the Telheimer Scholarship. And there were about, I don't know how many people, but maybe 15, 20 people won it that year. Ted Albano, my friend and roommate, and Rob Langevin, they were two that I remember that also won that scholarship. They tried to place us away from the Mount Royal freshman row, and they placed us over in a place with some quality artists so that we could really work and not be distracted by all the parties and the goings-ons over there with the party crew. And I'm so glad they did. They put me over there, and I spent a year there. I did have one troublesome roommate, but that's when I met Ted in 2D Design. And he remembered me, and I remembered him from the Telheimer workshops. And we got together and said, let's live together the next year. And so he had already had a place way off campus, but it was a nice little walk, no big deal. And that was the thing that changed my life, because Ted was everything that I wasn't. And Ted, he liked me because I was everything that he wasn't. You know, it's kind of like a guy-girl relationship. Why are you attracted to the opposite sex? Because they're special. but they're everything you're not. A guy can't imagine what it would be like to be a girl, so they're attracted. A girl can't imagine what it would be like to be a guy, so they're attracted. Well, Ted and I were both guys. We had things in our artistic presence that were just unique and we both admired. Well, we shared those gifts. We made each other more than we were. And now with No Canvas, I'm taking that on. That analytic process that we learned and gained and all the gifts that we gave one another, my gifts go on. I didn't die. He did. So not only do I have what he gave me, but I feel obligated to use what I learned because I'm using it for him as well. And now I've spent 30 years with art. And I'm going on and I'm trying to figure out what to do with it now. And I'm sharing that with you. Thank you for being here. Let's go down this road together. With No Canvas, subscribe right now.